Hey everybody, this is Patty with The Leather Lady. I hope everybody's doing good. I thought I'd come on and do another video and do some explaining of different saddle parts. Not only that, for the English, Australian, and Western, so that you guys can understand when you take them to get them repaired, refleeced, reflocked. You can see what it takes to actually get a saddle apart and put it back together. So I know a lot of you don't use Australian saddles very much, but I wanted to use this as an example because we really need to be mindful how things are put together for our safety when we're riding and keep ourselves safe in case the horse decides to rear, buck, tumble over, maybe tumble over on top of us. Have had that happen before, I'm sure you guys have. So this is where we're going to start. So we're going to start with the Australian saddle. And the thing is about an Australian saddle is they can come with a horn or without a horn. Now in Australia, they don't use horns. In fact, they sort of laugh at us if we're using horns. I've worked with a guy down, well, I didn't work with him. We've spoke several times. He makes Australian saddles down in California. And we talk a lot about the structure of the saddle and everything like that. And so the thing is, with the Australian saddle, they are made sort of like a Western slash English. So they look sort of English, but they've got the big, rolls in the front, but I'm talking about their tree. Their tree is almost like a Western tree made out of wood, but the structures on it are all sort of tied into it like an English saddle. So let's take a look at what I'm wanting to show you today. So I've taken this Australian saddle apart a little bit, and hopefully you can see. So we've got the front. They normally have two of these, correct? On both sides. And on this one here, the reason why I wanted to put this one back on so that you could see. So if you do have an Australian saddle, or you're riding in an Australian saddle and it's not yours and somebody else's horse, please be mindful that these things, when they're taken apart, I'm going to try to hold this a little bit. These things, when they come off, there is a big piece of metal sticking right up inside. Now you would think, oh, that's bendable. It is not. So if that horse were to tumble on top, there's no way. This is steel, and this is actually bolted. I've taken it apart. It is bolted inside the saddle really tight. Just like any of the hardware, the brass hardware that you see, these are all bolted inside. And even your pins or your buttons, if you want to call them, are bolted inside. So when I take this and look underneath, they're either bolted or they're wire twisted. So if you look at this one here, you've got these that are bolted in. Then you've also got this wire twist. Now, this was sort of easy for me to untwist, but if that untwisted for some reason in your saddle while you're riding, that would just definitely just puncture a wound in your horse. There is another layer of fabric underneath here, or leather underneath here, I'm going to show you, but I just wanted you to see the understructure of an Australian saddle. Now, when you guys have an Australian saddle, they're a little bit different. The billets are different than an English saddle, and it will cost you a lot. So if you got a little $200 Australian saddle, it's almost better to donate it somewhere, because these are your leathers. And these leathers actually go inside the tree. So in order for me to replace your leathers, I literally have to take this whole saddle apart. And you're like, well, it doesn't look that hard, right? Well, here's the bottom piece that I literally had to take off of this saddle. So this is the bottom piece of the saddle. So in order to get to just this part, I'm going to have to get to these, because I can't get in there with my hands or my arms. So just know that if you have an Australian saddle, look at how your leathers are together. Or the thing is that now what, like this gentleman does when he makes his Australian saddles, there is a piece that comes to here, and then you can detach it so that this one piece here is very short. So if you have an Australian saddle like this and you just can't part with it, then ask the person changing your leathers to create a piece that actually stops so you can attach and detach new leathers, and it'll save you a lot of money. So if you look under this tree, it actually has a wood tree, and it has some leather underneath it, but it also has a metal part, metal part here that holds the part of the bottom in. So when you're looking at one of these saddles, this will hold the base in, but when we look at the base, you'll see that it has to be all stitched in, all stitched around here, all stitched back up in here. So even when you go to refleece, full refleece an English saddle, this has to be done. You can get up into these. These are where the stitch marks are. This is where they would pull and take the wool fluff out, which this one stinks really bad because it wasn't taken care of. So you would want to remove that, put new fluff in, and then restitch it, put it back onto to the saddle. Every piece has to be restitched. As you can see, they've had little stitch marks, stitch lines all over. And then this is where the back piece comes in, where that little metal thing is to slide back on that saddle and hold it. The underside of this, just so you have a look at it, is similar to an English saddle on one of the panels. So it has your nice, but this is wool, so it has a nice wool covering. It has your dockets here that you would actually need to keep that in place, and then you're stitched back on just like a English saddle. So that is an Australian saddle. So when you go look at an English saddle, please be careful of your front. I'm actually pulling two saddles apart. I'm creating a new style of saddle just for myself, just to see, because I love playing with saddles. That's my thing. So on this one, we have an English, an older, not very well, cat whipped. But I used to ride in it until an English instructor said, don't ride in that anymore, because, yeah, I couldn't keep my seat, and it didn't fit the horse very well. So it was very good. But as we see here now, if you need billets, yes, I do billets. So when we look under the bottom of this one here, you've got your normal three billets, right? Those are easily to be replaced. Most of them I can do by hand, or whoever is doing your saddle can get in here and do them by hand. Now, depending on the saddle maker, dressage, all-purpose, all the different kinds of saddles and how they choose to do it, they can actually get so far up in this part that we have to actually release some of the saddle to do that. Luckily, I haven't had to do that yet so far, but it sometimes happens. In all the years I've done them. So when I do create billets, just so you know, for people that don't even know I do billets, I create and make my own billets out of really quality leather. They're oiled and conditioned really good. That's why they cost a little bit more. I can buy billets, but we never know what kind of leather we're getting, or how the quality, if it's a 1, a 2, a 3, that kind of thing, because most of Europe gets our high quality leather, our skirting leather, our saddle leather. So South America sends it straight to Europe first. They get the first pick, then we get the rest. So anyway, so and then the bottom of your saddle your English saddle. So maybe some of you guys are wondering, how do I know when it's time to flock? Or how about spot flock? Have you ever heard of spot flocking? Probably not. And I'm getting some glare off my glasses. Sorry. So let me tell you this. There's ways to tell, and it's ways to tell if you're off balance on your saddle, on your English saddle as well. That's what we do when we try to figure out saddle fitting and things like that. But if you've got a English saddle that actually is all smooth and really smooth, everything is even, both sides are completely even, there's no holes, no little cellulite holes kind of thing, then you're probably pretty good. But when you start seeing these kind of things in your saddles, these are pressure points, okay, and that needs to be spot, either spot reflocked, or maybe you're starting to have a new flocking. Now, the thing is, the reason why you guys need to really take good care of your saddles, because to fully reflock your saddle is going to cost you $400, $500, maybe $600. And that is because, again, as you saw, we have to pull the saddle apart. Now, sometimes we can do a spot flock depending on what the product is inside and get up in there with tools and actually spot flock that. But when you go to buy a saddle, watch out for these things. Don't just look at the seat. Don't go and just look at, always this leather. Oh, I could condition it. It's a little bit older, worn, especially for your kids, because here's what happens. These pressure points, when you're riding, they give sores to the horses. So you do not want to have something that's going to create a sore or going to create a pressure point on your horse. So that is the two key points on this English saddle I wanted to show you. And then also, too, in the front, you've got your leather holders. Please make sure that you maybe put a little WD-40 on those every now and then, or some lightning silver, that kind of thing, a little spray, just to keep them loose and keep them, and they will last a lot longer. I don't know how many I get in that I can't even hardly bend them. So, and then to replace those, you're costing a lot too, because we got to take it out and take it apart. So that's the English saddle. Sort of an idea. Just a real quick review, because a lot of people ask me, how much does it cost to flock a saddle? How much does it cost? And people just don't understand the intense amount of work. Now, we're on the West Coast, or I'm on the West Coast, right? If you were going to go down to California or East Coast to have a reflocking done, you're looking at a lot more than $600 to have that done. To have a reflocking done on a Australian saddle, it's about pretty much the same. So if that's why you have to really wonder, do you want to spend that kind of money on an Australian saddle? So they're usually not popular. You can usually pick up an Australian saddle for $250, $50 sometimes. They're just not well taken care of, and that's something. But here's the thing, though. If you go to an African safari, they do use a very similar thing to the Australian saddle for their horses, because they're light, they're easy to take care of, they're easy to ride in, they're comfortable, and that's what they use. Anyway, so let's look at, the other thing too is, notice that some of these buttons that you think that are on your saddles, you think, oh, those are really easy to just undo and put back in. Not really, because they've got a bolt, and that bolt's got to be inside, especially for your Australians. But even on your English, sometimes they'll have a little bolt. So you've got to get in there and replace those. It's not that they just screw in like some Western saddles and then screw back out. Not all makers are that way. Some makers want to cut corners, sell it to you, and then, you have to repair it later. A good English saddle maker, if you have a part that has broken, you can contact that maker and say, hey, do you have any spare parts? Because if you want me to repair something, it's better to have an original part from the maker who's actually made the saddle than have to have me go find a substitute that maybe not be as good quality. So when we're looking at Western saddles, for those of you that are Western, this is an old 100-year saddle. I love it. I'm actually refacing it. It used to be my beau's horse, but a hit for him, but he's gone now. Anyway, I love it because you know what? You would think that a hard seat on a saddle is really uncomfortable, but I've ridden in so many different kinds of saddles and types of saddles that this is the most comfortable you could ever have. You can throw a sheepskin on it if you want to, but oh my gosh, riding the trails, this was so comfortable. And the reason being is because of the type of tree it's in, also where the stirrups are placed, the fenders are placed. So I have this off here, and you can see here's the bottom of it. I'm gonna see if I can stretch this. I'm just starting to put this back on. I was going to use it for an example, though. So if you look underneath, you can see that it's all wood, right? Some of them are rawhide covered. If you're going to get a real Western saddle, best is to get a Western saddle with a rawhide cover on its tree. This is called a tree. This is what we sit on. So if you bring me your saddle to be refleeced, like I'm doing here, what I do is I pull everything off, and then I inspect the tree, I inspect the holes. So, for example, this one here, if you look closely, hopefully it's not too dark, you can see it's starting to split. This wood is starting to split. So maybe we need to take care of those. Maybe we need to let the owner know, hey, or I can actually see if a tree is split. If a tree is split, that's it. We cannot fix that tree. We can if we want to take the whole saddle apart and rebuild it and put it all back together. Depends on how sentimental that is. It costs you almost the price of a new saddle. You're looking at about $1,000 or more to do that. So because we not only, a western tree to build a saddle is, my mentor's been gone for 3-4 years now. Back then it was $500 for a tree. So when you go and you buy a new saddle that has a tree in that, then you're looking at just the tree alone. So if you're buying a saddle for $1,500, can you imagine how much time and effort and everything, skills and trade, a saddlesmith has put into that? And people complain about $1,000 for their time and their materials. One hide, it takes two hides for a saddle, and one hide is going to cost a saddle maker, depending on the place, it could run you $110 to $180, sometimes $200 a hide. And so you're looking at $400 there. So you're looking at almost $1,000, and that's not including the hardware and everything, to put into a saddle. And so so these are really important things. Now, somebody can probably hear somebody saying, well, I have a treeless saddle. Well, don't ask me about treeless saddles because I have my own opinion about them. And then also, too, well, I have a fiberglass tree. Well, fiberglass trees do not give like wood does. Fiberglass is firm, it's hard, it's rigid, and you're going to end up with more sores than an actual wood tree. So again, each saddle maker is his own, but if you go to a saddle maker and you start talking about synthetic trees or plastic trees, things like that. Also, too, if you're in an accident, they don't hold up. They don't bend and flex like a regular, so you could actually get hurt even more. So that's all I'm going to say about that. So anyway, I wanted you to see the underside. So when I take this apart, I actually look at I recondition. I'm going to pull this back a little bit. I don't like to leave saddles on their horns. But I recondition the leathers here. I recondition everything underneath because how many years has somebody ridden in this? This is a 100-year-old saddle. So somebody actually probably has taken care of this besides myself really well because the leather is stiff, but it's not really hard. So it's really important that, you know, you take care of your saddles. I will say that on your fenders also, because I just did this and it drove me nuts. Now, this is a different kind of, but when you buckle into your fenders here, so you have your, I'm going to try to bring this saddle over. This is the one. So you have your Blevins underneath here, right? Please be sure to clean your Blevins. Because here's the thing, if you have them in the trailers, you have them in the weather, you have them in the elements of the skin, the sweat, and everything else, what happens is, and they get rusted. This one here, one of the Blevin things broke off. And the thing is that they will rust and corrode to your leather. And then we can't get them off, so then we have to cut the leather. And if it is too short, we may need to have new leathers, and that's going to cost you even more. Just take care of your equipment. That's all I can say. Really take, if you don't have the products, call me. I sell products. I sell cleaning. I sell conditioning. I sell all the supplies, not only for saddlery and tack, but I also sell supplies like dyes and leathers and scrap leather and all that kind of stuff. Whatever you need for leather craft, I can get it for you. So with this, back to the refleecing. So I condition everything here. And then what happens is I have to place not only this leather back on, but there are several layers of leather. So I have to go in before I even start and unstitch all that bad stitching. Then I have to go ahead and pull all the threads out of the holes. Then when I have to go put it back together, so I have to glue the fleece down. We call it a shearling. I have to glue the shearling down, cut it, fit it, make sure it all works and it's perfectly. And then I have to go hand restitch. Remember, I don't know if you've seen that video before, but I say do not even take any leather to a sewing machine, because these holes, if you actually miss the hole, you're actually stripping it and hitting where the good leather is to create that, so that we can bind that. So most leather work, saddle work, is done by hand. New saddle works, we definitely can do on some parts on the machines, but a lot of it is done by hand. That's why saddlesmith is a trade and unfortunately a dying art. So if you know a saddlesmith, please support them. And when they make their saddles, please just, you know, acknowledge them for all the hard work that they do, because they don't even get paid really for what the workload that they do. They do it because they love it, is why they do it. So that is the video on some different saddle types, what some of the parts are, also some things to look for on the English saddle, the Australian saddle, and the Western saddle. I hope you enjoyed this. Please, if you're watching it on YouTube, please like, share, and subscribe. If you're watching it on Facebook or on my website, please like and let me know what you think. Please, I'd love to have comments below. Take care now. You guys have a great, great, great rest of the week.